Hi, I'm Brian Kellerman, the co-founder and chief food safety officer at Kellerman Consulting, and you are watching our video series on corrective and preventive actions. In our previous video, we introduced the problems that can occur in the facility that we can label as nonconformances, deviations, loss of control, errors, or mishaps. In this video, we are going to look at root cause investigations, corrective actions, and preventive actions, as well as documentation of these investigations and their corrective actions. As we explore these concepts of root cause analysis and corrective action, we are going to include a look at some ideas of how to know when to record problematic events and what level of deviation or problematic event rises to the level of needing to perform this analysis and the follow-up actions. Many facilities deal with errors and deviations informally. They find something wrong, fix it, and move on. While it is important to fix problems when they arise, without properly documenting those problems and their fixes, we are often doomed to repeat those deviations or errors over and over, without recognizing the underlying reasons and without taking steps to implement permanent fixes. The stronger we are in identifying and recording nonconformances, deviations, and errors, and the better we are in following through with recording corrections and corrective actions in our operation, the stronger the culture of food safety will ultimately be, and the more likely we will be in meeting regulatory and audit requirements when review of our program occurs. So let's dive into main concepts, starting with corrections. A correction is an immediate fix when something goes wrong in operations. We discussed this in the context of a process deviation, but this can also be applied to our facility issues. An example of a correction would be getting an employee to fix the wearing of a hairnet or gloves, mopping up a spill on the floor, getting a hose off the floor and capped, or recleaning a piece of equipment that fails preoperative inspection. Generally, when leadership or quality assurance performs regular walkthroughs, this is the most likely source of observations that lead to corrections. During our walkthroughs, as we observe people, materials, or machinery out of place, we should direct employees to adjust those things back to the way they should be, and then we should check back later to make sure the correction held. Once we have identified areas or people associated with corrections, that should give us a reference point for future walkthroughs as a place to start looking for where corrections may be necessary. It is through these walkthroughs and observations that regular corrections occur, and in performing these corrections, we can control problem areas. The observations and resulting corrections should be documented where possible, and this would be such as through an email, written note, or a nonconformance report. And this is in cases involving a significant issue. However, when a correction is performed in operations in a non-critical area, it may not be necessary to document these each time they occur, as this information may not be necessary. It is really up to leadership to determine how to handle the documentation of these non-critical corrections. Where we definitely need to be recording corrections is where they occur in operational processes, which, for example, would be the fixing of cooking, cooling, acidification, or drying of food, or where a preventive control is not performed correctly. We also may need to record corrections where we have the same deviations over and over again. Just remember, corrections that occur without subsequent changes in policies, procedures, or equipment are not corrective actions and do not have an associated preventive action. As we move away from corrections that occur during operations, we want to move our attention to corrective actions, which happen separately from corrections, and which require a change or update to our system as a result of the issue observed. Corrections performed on the spot, such as hanging up a mop or a hose, should not be considered a corrective action. The reason for this is because whatever caused the deviation event to occur in the first place is not addressed through that correction. In this example, the hose or mop was on the ground because someone put it there and either didn't know to hang it up or did not feel that it was their responsibility. By hanging up that mop or hose, it's no longer on the ground, but we are likely to find it back there on the ground in the future. The only way to assure that we will change the behavior is to update policies and procedures to eliminate that behavior or to put a new policy in place where one does not already exist. The other option is to retrain employees if the policy is in place and is simply not being followed. An example of a corrective action as opposed to a correction may be installing new equipment or safety guards, adding a new monitoring form at a step where issues occur, hiring new employees, or changing employee roles. With both corrections and corrective actions, what we want to look for is where deviations, nonconformances, or other issues continue to occur in operation. Where the same correction is being performed over and over, we need to put a corrective action in place that has measure to prevent the needed correction. Where corrective actions are piling up, we have a larger organizational issue that needs to be addressed. There is only so much time and so many pages we can have in our policies and procedures, and if we are adding to them constantly in response to deviations, loss of control, errors, or mishaps, we can quickly get to a place where the documents are too long, too difficult to read, or too complex for a median employee to follow. When we are performing a corrective action, and even when a correction is performed, we should be investigating why the deviation, loss of control, error, or mishap occurred. This is what we refer to as a root cause analysis. When we are attempting to determine a root cause, we can generally break it down to two types of problems. Problems with obvious root causes, such as a door to a closet that is left unlocked where only one or two employees have keys or combinations to open them, and problems that do not have clear causes, such as plastic pieces found in product. When deviations, loss of control, and nonconformances occur where there are clear root causes, these are extremely important to document for a couple of reasons. First, it is important to have a written record of what occurred so that long after the fact there is a clear understanding of changes to the system after the problems occurred. And second, it is proof that your team can find problems and identify the cause. This is especially important to have on hand during regulatory reviews or audits. So make sure that you have someone on your team writing these down when they occur. For deviations, loss of control, and nonconformances where the problems are not clear, it is quite a bit more complicated to know how to handle the situation. It is disconcerting when a problem arises and we aren't clear why. Sometimes it is just a one-off occurrence. But other problems may be the start of a pattern that can lead to repeated problems. Where problems arise where the reason is unclear, quality managed system tools such as 5Y or fishbone exercises can be used to help identify the root cause in a complex issue. Both of these tools are readily available as templates online, and we recommend downloading a form to have handy for tough-to-solve nonconformances. But remember, if you are going to perform a 5Y or a fishbone exercise, leadership needs to be on hand for these sessions, and a sufficient amount of time needs to be devoted to the process, so a quick 5-minute huddle is not going to work. The purpose of a root cause analysis is to identify the true cause of a deviation, because without knowing this information, we cannot implement effective corrections or corrective actions. Nor can we put measures in place to prevent reoccurrence of the deviations. Regardless of whether a root cause analysis is an open and shut situation or a mystery requiring real detective work, usually the solution involves a preventive action as part of the fix. So let's dig into those types of actions. Where a corrective action is a fix for an event that has already occurred, a preventive action is an update or change to policies to make sure that it is very unlikely or impossible for a repeat occurrence. An example of a preventive action is installing a guardrail on a shipping dock after a forklift has banged into racks on a sharp corner. The addition of the guardrail makes it very unlikely that the corner of the racks will continue to be damaged by a forklift. For root cause analysis investigations with simple issues, we can often put something quickly into place to make sure it doesn't occur again, as would be the case where we replace a rusted out Hobart mixer after we find metal and rust in product during ingredient mixing. The new equipment should prevent reoccurrence, and writing down the purchase as a preventive action will do. For the unexplained or unclear errors in a facility, Where corrective action cannot easily be determined, preventive action is likely the only way to make sure to prevent a reoccurrence, even when we can't get clearly to why it happened. An example of this would be where we get a positive result for a pathogen in a hallway leading to production. Unless we have a history of the pathogen or a clear event leading up to the finding of it, we are probably stuck with several competing reasons for the undesirable test results. The preventive action here is likely to be crucial in the final decision making because while the corrective action of performing expanded testing in an area will help understand how exposed the area is, and the cleaning and sanitation will remove the surface pathogen, identifying how to make sure the undesirable results do not continue is more difficult. In this environmental pathogen example, putting a sanitation bath for employees to step in before entering the hallway, or repairing cracks in the floors, walls, and ceilings are examples of preventive actions. Even in the absence of clear root causes, preventive actions such as this are not only likely to meet regulatory and audit requirements, but can also provide lasting protection against that problem going forward. Now that we have provided a basic definition for types of process and facility deviations or nonconformances, as well as corrections, corrective actions, and preventive actions, we can begin to look at how to record them and how management can review them as part of a culture of food safety in the facility. Again, your facility should have written findings of nonconformances and deviations, and you should have written corrections, corrective actions, and preventive actions addressing those errors. Thank you for watching. For more food safety training videos, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.